Welcome to Celebrating Act Two with Manny Pacheco and my good partner, what's his name? Oh, John Coleman. And what's going on, guys?
Manny, you have been teasing us with an idea that you've got an actor to talk about, a famous actor that we all know and love, but we don't talk about. Who could be that famous actor? I can't imagine.
Well, we always talk about it. It seems like we're always talking about Bogey or Spencer Tracy, right? Or Gable, right? or Cagney. We always seem to talk about them. We don't talk about Gary Cooper as much.
Gary Cooper.
Yeah, really good actor who spent a good portion of the 1930s at Paramount Pictures, made just a litany of great films, and as good as it gets. I mean, as far as the kings of Hollywood's golden age, he's certainly one of them.
Do you suppose, Manny, we don't talk about him as much because maybe his private life wasn't as exciting as the other guys?
Well, his private life actually was quite exciting, and we can get into that later. I could talk a little bit about that. But I will tell you that I think most of the situation here is that he wasn't at he was at Paramount Pictures, which is a big place to be. But you know, he couldn't make movies with other leading men that were, like, let's say, at MGM or at Warner Brothers. And so, you know, whoever was at Paramount, that's who we would work with. And he did. But he made some great films. And it just seems to me whenever his name comes up, two films always emerge and then everything else gets forgotten. You talk about Sergeant York. Won an Academy Award. High Noon, he won an Academy Award, two-time Oscar winner. But boy, he sure did more than that.
Well, you're going to tell us.
Oh, well, by all means, let's do it. Well, it starts with how he was discovered. He was discovered by the great director William Wellman, and he was put in a bit role, a tragic role, as a matter of fact, in the first film to ever win an Oscar, and that was Wings. And he has like one scene, but after that one scene played across the country, his fan mail actually tripled, maybe even increased by tenfold. So, I mean, he became a true iconic star with just one scene in the first Best Picture movie, Wings. And that's impressive. That's really, really impressive. And then he went on to make a lot of Westerns. In the 1930s. In fact, he kind of became the Western star of the 19. John Wayne was making Westerns, but nobody would ever say that in 1935, 36, 37, that John Wayne was the Western guy. It was Gary Cooper. Gary Cooper was the Western guy with movies like The Plainsman and The Westerner. He worked really well with Walter Brennan, who again would play opposite some of the great Western stars, including James Stewart and John Wayne. I mean, Walter Brennan always worked with the best, and one of the best, of course, was Gary Cooper. And Gary Cooper was a star. I mean, he wasn't working B pictures. He was working with top actors like Gene Arthur and others. And as a matter of fact, one director found that he would be perfect for his Everyman roles that would later go to people like James Stewart. And that was Frank Capra. Frank Capra thought, boy, I really need this guy in my films. And he put him in two of his iconic films. Everybody thinks of Frank Capra. They think of It's a Wonderful Life and Mr. Smith Goes to Washington. But Gary Cooper was in two of those films. He was in Mr. Deeds Goes to Town and in Meet John Doe. Yes. And he worked with Gene Arthur and Barbara Stanwyck. And man, these films were hugely popular. Really was part of Frank Capra's fold of those important Everyman pictures. And all it did was just solidify Gary Cooper's bona fides. So there you go.
Hmm. So why do you think he's the Rodney Dangerfield of our conversations? why do you think that he doesn't get as much play?
Well,
and not just from us. I mean, from everybody. You don't hear a whole lot about him. He didn't have a romance with another leading lady or something where he, you know, bogey him a call and what have you. What do you think the reason is?
At the time, he was every big an actor as Gable. Gable was the king because that's what MGM says. But, you know, MGM only polled people about MGM stars. I'm sure that if Gary Cooper had been in the mix, he would have been considered as well as one of the kings of Hollywood. So he was very, very popular in the 1930s, just like Gable. And I will go so far as to say that he was considered for a supporting role in Gone with the Wind to play Ashley Wilkes. Imagine Ashley Wilkes being Gary Cooper instead of Leslie Howard opposite Gable. Oh, I think that works great because nobody believes that Vivian Leigh falls for a wimpy guy like Leslie Howard. Not even Leslie Howard believed it. He thought, he was like, oh, no, I'm the wrong guy. I'm too old. It doesn't work. They needed somebody like an Errol Flynn, who unfortunately had too much of the same mustache that Gable had, or a Gary Cooper. Gary Cooper, in my mind, might have been the best Ashley Wilkes because he could have been able to stand up a little bit to Clark Gable in terms of stage presence, screen presence. And so, you know, I think that would have been but again, Paramount wouldn't release him. And so he just never had the opportunity.
Manny, you mentioned Jimmy Stewart. Were Clark Gable and Jimmy Stewart, weren't they kind of competing for they weren't competing because they were in different studios, but were they competing for the same kinds of roles? Did they fulfill that icon, the same icon, but from different studios?
You mean from Gary Cooper versus Jimmy Stewart?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, it would have been no contest. Number one, Jimmy Stewart was younger than Cagney, Gable, Spencer Tracy, Humphrey Bogart, and Gary Cooper. He was younger by 7 years.
Yeah.
So he always came in kind of as the supporting player initially. Like he supports William Powell in one of the Thin Man series. He supports Spencer Tracy in a movie called Murder Man. He supports everybody until he comes onto his own and wins. You know, once he was in Mr. Smith Goes to Washington, that changed everything. But that was, by then, that was 1939. Gary Cooper was an established star for a decade at that point. And then, as the 40s approach, what does he do? He makes two of the most iconic films that sets him up for that Oscar for Sergeant York. And the first one was a screwball comedy with Howard Hawks, Ball of Fire with Barbara Stanwyck. And oh my God, he plays a professor. Talk about out of type. He plays this kind of frumpy professor with eight other bachelor professors that are clearly older than him. But he falls for this showgirl played by Barbara Stanwyck. And he's basically trying to learn the ideas of slang. So she's helping him learn how to speak slang because he's so frumpy. And it's a great comedy with support from a young Dana Andrews. Of course, he would come onto his own and become a leading actor 5 years later. And Dan Duryea is in it, and S.Z. Sakal, Oscar Homolka. I mean, some great, great actors. Henry Travers, all in support of Gary Cooper and Barbara Stanwyck. In fact, one of the funniest scenes is when she teaches him yum yum, which is how to kiss twice. There's yum, and then they kiss, and then there's yum yum, and they kiss twice again. And it's very, very, it's really, the chemistry is undeniable. But then he follows that up with one of the most tremendously poignant movies about a man who was still alive when I believe the film was made, but then was shortly thereafter die. And that was Lou Gehrig's story in Pride of the Yankees.
Oh, yeah.
And you know, he was so good opposite Teresa Wright, which I believe was probably the perfect leading lady for Gary Cooper because he's so, you know, he's so quiet and so he underplays everything. And Teresa Wright is so magnificent in her stoicism. I think they make a great screen couple. Yes. And they were, in fact, they were both nominated for Oscars for Pride of the Yankees.
Well, that was a great film.
Yeah.
That was a great film.
Really.
So before we finish with Gary Cooper, now that we've spent a whole bunch of time on him, we have barely mentioned Gable and Spencer Tracy in this conversation. So We're giving them some respect. We're putting them on a bit of a pedestal there. Can you share any dirt? Come on, something unseemly. Come on, to Mr. Well, Nice Guy.
Gary Cooper, by after the war, just like James Stewart, wanted to do more serious films, and unfortunately, he didn't fare as well as James Stewart, because then James Stewart started getting all the good Western parts. Now, he did get High Noon, but here's the deal. Gary Cooper did not age as gracefully as, let's say, Gable or Stewart. He really looked tired in his films, and he started taking roles where he would really end up the loser in the film. You know, when you got Gary Cooper, why is he losing in a film? But movies like The Fountainhead, and he started make a movie called a really minor Western called Bright Leaf, The Court Martial of Billy Mitchell, even his last film, Naked Edge, he looks tired and worn out. If you really look at High Noon closely, as magnificent as he is, he really looks beat up in the film. Of course, he's supposed to. Yeah. But all of his films in the 1950s, he looks tired. And I believe it's because he was suffering from cancer for a long time. And that's what eventually took him. But as far as dirt goes, in the early 30s and 40s, he was rumored to have dated, I can't even tell you how many women. And all of the women would say he was notable for one specific thing that I'm not going to go into.
But it was a big deal, wasn't it?
It was a big deal.
Yeah.
A really big deal. Yeah. Oh, one other thing I should mention, too, and this is not, you know, by any ways, you know, lurid in any way, but he was also a great horseman. He's from Montana. And he knew how to handle a horse when he was very young. Nobody could get on and off a horse and even do tricks. I mean, this side the comedian, the folks person, I can't believe I'm drawing a blank on his
name. All right, Johnny Mac Brown is not the name you're looking for.
No, I'm not. No, I'm talking about a comedian and Western star.
Yeah, you're not talking about Billy Crystal.
Will Rogers. This side of Will Rogers, there was just nobody better than Gary Cooper with a horse. Will Rogers was amazing with a horse as well. But Gary Cooper was a noted horseman. His whole career should have been Westerns, as far as I'm concerned. But unfortunately, or maybe fortunately for the people who watch his films, he was just too good an actor. He could play in any kind of movie. Rom-coms of the day of the 1940s. He was good with mysteries. He was good with biographies. He, you know, Sergeant York and Pride of the Yankees are biographies. He was good in war films. He was just good in everything. But really, he could have had an entire career of just Westerns.
Wow.
Well, you know what? I now buy your premise. I happen to agree with you. You're right. Gary Cooper is often overlooked. I don't think we've talked about him before,
have we? Until today. We've changed it. I have a course of history today. Gary Cooper is El Capo, is the Don.
Among his pallbearers, Van Heflin. And James Stewart. In fact, I will go so far as that weeks before he was dying, and everybody in the industry knew he was dying. People, you know, the fans didn't, but everybody in the industry knew he was dying. And so months before he died, the Academy, even though he's a two-time Oscar winner, they bestowed him a special Oscar that was given to him in a presentation made on television by James Stewart, no less. So if there's anybody who was really Hollywood royalty in the most magnificent way, it truly was Gary Cooper.
Yeah.
Wow.
Manny, thank you so much.
My pleasure.
For more on Celebrating Act Two, visit our webpage, follow us on Facebook, subscribe to us on YouTube, and tell your friends. Celebrating Act Two is the user manual for the second half of your life.